So good morning. I'll tell you a little bit today about some of the work that we do in our lab. So I was at work one day and I received this text message from my barber, and the title was "Recycling at its Best." And when I looked at the message, it was a link to a news article in which people were using adipose cells to do some therapy. And so we're doing, it's pretty much the same thing. We're using some fat cells to do some regeneration. So I call this recycling at its best. Just to give you a little bit of a motivation as to why we're taking the approach that we're taking, right? We're really interested in looking at bone grafts or craniofacial applications. And within the craniofacial region, what I like to show here is that the bone structure is really what dictates your facial features, right? So the soft, all the soft tissue is given its appearance by the underlying bone structure. And for someone like this, so I got this from a plastic surgeon that I collaborate with. For someone like this, what they'll typically do to regenerate this bone is to take the fibula, which is this bone along the calf, on the outside of the calf, and try to break it up into pieces to fit across these different structures here. And if it's the bone that's giving you the structure of your face, you can imagine that this person's face is not going to really look normal if you were to take these long pieces of straight bone and try to make a anatomically shaped structure from that. The other approach is to take some titanium meshes, but the titanium meshes doesn't work well with the soft tissue in the face. And so there is a need to have some other type of bone graft that's going to give you the appropriate anatomical shape. And the way that we're looking at doing it is to do tissue engineering. And so I'll give you a little bit of background about tissue engineering. What is it? And it falls from this idea that cells obviously are going to give rise to tissues which come together to form organs. And the key concept is that these tissues are not just a collection of cells, but these cells, the spatial organization of these cells, the way that they interact with each other, the way that they interact with the matrix within the tissue is really what drives the, what provides the structure of the tissue. And therefore, how do we, if we're taking cells to use this to form a new tissue, how do we guide these, how do we stimulate these cells to form new tissues? And the key thing comes from the idea that from this review paper is that cells are really able to respond to a number of different cues within their microenvironment. So essentially what you're seeing here is that these cells can attach to their whatever matrix they're on within this tissue, and they can respond to physical cues. So that point was brought up a little bit earlier in one of the talks this morning. They can respond to physical cues, they can respond to stretches, to compression, to these different things. And so really it's our goal is to understand what are these cells, or how are these cells integrating all those different cues to come up with a specific response, and to guide those responses for the specific tissues of interest. And the way we do that is to use what we call bioreactor systems. Alright, so this really gets to the heart of the matter as to what is tissue engineering. And really what we do is to really try to understand what cues these cells are seeing. So it was mentioned this morning when we talked that we all start with one cell. Right? And these cells go, these cells develop to form all these different various tissues, structures within the body. And so really trying to understand what those cells are seeing. Here, so this, we kind of call these the in vivo cues. They see oxygen, different nutrients, different soluble factors, etc. And we're trying to use that understanding to guide the all development of these in vitro cues. Right? So we have these, so essentially we're trying to match what the cells see within the body with what we can show, what we can do within the bioreactor. And we start by putting these cells within these scaffolds. And these scaffolds essentially form a template for these cells. It's pretty much how a scaffold works for a building. It defines the internal architecture. So these little pore spaces would be like the rooms that we have here. So the scaffold properties itself, it defines what the shape and structure of those rooms would be. But it also defines the outer limits of the building, what the shape of the building is going to look like. Alright, and so we put these cells within these scaffolds, and within these bioreactor systems here, and I won't describe this one in detail, but I'll get into it on a later slide, you can guide these various environmental cues, and that's going to lead us to engineering tissue. And so how people have used this for a number of different tissues within the last couple of decades. Just to quickly kind of recap some of these, people, a lot of people have seen this already, right? This is the ear and the back of the mouse. So it's pretty much the same approach. They put cells within a scaffold and against certain factors. This work was done, which essentially this person had his finger cut off. They provided this is a mucosal membrane. small intestines, you just see the top of the intestines. And essentially cues, the biological cues present within this tissue were able to help the regeneration of this finger. People have done it for bladder, this is genitalia. They've done it for heart structures, they've done it for your lungs. Right? And in each case, essentially what they're doing, they're providing structures to these cells. These scaffolds provide a structure to the cells that they can use to guide the cells into to becoming whatever tissue of interest. And so I'll tell you today, our approach for looking to generate vascularized bone grafts for cranial facial applications. And because we talk about, again, the face providing that structure, and a person's appearance is very important for their own sense of self, right? And so if you're talking about cranial facial graft, you want it to be specific to that patient. And if it has to be specific to that patient, then you have to have essentially an image-based approach. You need to be able to image what that patient looks like or used to look like if their face is damaged. And to provide a scaffold that is able to recapitulate that shape of interest. You're going to put cells inside of that scaffold, and somehow you want to guide those cells to become the tissues of interest, the bone tissues and the vascular tissues, that you can then take and reimplant into this patient. So our study, we did a proof of principle study which looked at essentially looking at the temporal mandibular joint. The temporal mandibular joint is this joint right in front of the ear that allows you to open your mouth, chew for speaking, etc. So this little condyle right in front of you. And this is kind of a proof of principle patient who had traumatic injury to the left side of his face. As you can see, like all these bones here are damaged. We focus specifically on the condyle, but essentially you can image this patient. And you can then find the contralateral side to this, right? So you can reflect this image and you can make a graft in that particular shape. So we look at a traumatic incident here. Several years ago when I was explaining this TMJ concept to people, I googled causes of TMJ disorders online. For some reason, this was the paper that came up on Google. I'm pretty sure this is not how most people get TMJ. But anyways, it's interesting that it came up. So our approach was to take this image of the TMJ disorder, extract this shape as shown here, and we could then make a scaffold in this exact shape of interest. Interestingly, this scaffold is taken from a cow's knee. Right, so we take the cow's knee, we take the spongy part of the bone from the cow's knee, removed all the cellular material from that region there. And so we left with this scaffold. So the scaffold, as I said before, it gives you this external shape as well as the internal architecture. But as you imagine, because it's taken from bone, it also has the biochemical effects that will induce cells to behave like bone cells. So we took bone marrow-derived stem cells. We're using human cells in our study. We took bone marrow-derived stem cells, and we put those cells inside of the scaffolds here. So these cells are inside of the solution. This will be inverted, and it will essentially be rotated. And so the cells, as they pass through the pore spaces of the scaffold, they hit the walls and they stick to the walls. And so if you do a histology, and this is what it looks like immediately after seeding, the cells are just on this. This red represents the actual mineral material that's there. And then these cells are along the surface. And you can see if you stain the cells to see whether or not they're alive, they all stain green, which means in this case that they're alive. So you want to culture these cells over a period of time in vitro to see whether or not you can actually generate new bone using this. And the way we did that was to generate this custom design bioreactor. And what this reactor is intended to do is to flow the medium that the cells reside in, flow it through the pore spaces of these scaffolds. And essentially, you have to force the medium through. So you're going to have an inlet. This is our inlet. And our scaffold will be inside this dark razor mold, which exactly encases the scaffold. And so the medium is forced to flow through the pore spaces, and then it will flow out of these different grafts here. So this gives a relative size of what the bioreactor is like. And the reason for that is that this scaffold is about a centimeter and a half across. It's not at the size there that's really clinically relevant for bone, but actually it's much larger than anything you can grow outside of the body at this point in time, and I'll tell you why in a couple of slides. Just to give you a better idea of how the bioreactor is put across, it's very modular. So you can imagine that if the shape changes, we can just change this mold that it fits into. Right, this mold is made out of silicone. It's very cheap to make this mold, and so essentially the way it comes together is that it just fits, everything just fits in like this. takes 10 seconds by computer, it takes several hours by hand to do it. But we run this, and you can cultivate cells ex vivo for several weeks. And when you cultivate, the reason we would do that, just to guide you, the reason why you would do that, if you don't have that perfusion, if you don't have that media flowing through, essentially what happens is that the cells are in this scaffold, right? So you can imagine, again, the cells, this room being the scaffold, the cells are inside, and the cells that are on the outside are closest to the medium and the nutrients and the oxygen. And those being closest to the medium, nutrients and oxygen are going to form their tissues, and then they're going to block off everything from the cells, or the medium and nutrients for the cells on the inside. And so if you cut the scaffold and you look at the inside of it, you can see mostly it's acellular. There are no cells that really reside in the inner of it. And whatever tissue does form is a very loose tissue. Versus if you were able to perfuse the scaffold over a period of time, and then you can actually have this very dense tissue that forms throughout the entire scaffold. And that's going to be important for the structure, for the quality of the bone that you can form within these constructs. So that helps us to do one aspect of it, of overcoming one aspect of one challenge. The other challenge is if you were to take that same graft and put it inside of the body, there's still no blood vessels supplied to it. And so if you look at this, the blood vessels, just this image is just kind of to guide you as to what is the distance between blood vessels, capillary vessels, within tissues. This distance is less than 1/5 of a millimeter. And I just told you that scaffold is about 1.5 centimeters. Right, so all that tissue that we're able to grow on the inside of it is going to die once we implant it into the body because there's no blood supply that's going to lead to that. And blood is going to grow into it, but the length of time it takes for blood to grow into that vessel, the cells are still going to, there's going to be a lot of necrosis and there's going to be a lot of cell death at that point in time. And so the tissue engineering approach to do this is to figure out, is there a way to pre-vascularize those scaffolds? And this is the conceptual approach. And this, several mention was made today of endothelial cells, right? So the cells that actually give rise to these capillary-like structures. And the idea is to put some of these endothelial cells inside of these tissues, and you can guide these endothelial cells in culture to form these primitive network structures. And then the hope is that if you were to implant this tissue, then the blood vessels within the body wouldn't have to grow through this entire construct, but it would just have to connect to these primitive network structures that exist already, right? And so it essentially can be completely vascularized. So we did that, and not to harp on this study, but just to show it as a proof that we're able to do it with endothelial cells, we used, as was mentioned before, umbilical vein endothelial cells. Together with our bone marrow derived stem cells, we're able to get some vasculature, and then when we implanted it, we're able to see some of these vessels became perfused with the human blood, we implanted it into rats, and so they connected with the rat vasculature and they were able to become perfused. But the problem is, if you're thinking about doing it translationally, that we're using umbilical vein cells, for most of us, we don't have our cells from the umbilical vein, right? And so you're going to have to start thinking about immunosuppression, etc. And so the better way to do it, a more ideal way to do it would be to use your own cells to generate. And this is where we come across the concept of using fat tissue to generate some of our cells. So stem cells, so within this fat tissue, there are a number of different types of cells that are present there. Stem cells also being among them. This review article didn't look at the use of stem cells, but even considering the earlier talk by Erica, where is the niche for these stems? It's really not known, not really well understood where are stem cells residing within this fat tissue. Actually, one of the ideas is that these cells, known as pericytes that line the blood vessels, are actually some of these stem cells, they share similar properties. But we can take this fat tissue, and usually you can get it from liposuction. And most people, it's a less morbid approach than that's typically used, right? So it's pretty easy, I guess, clinically, to get some like aspirate tissue.